the largest mass extinctions in Earth's history, the most well-known is probably the one involving dinosaurs and an asteroid. But what exactly caused all the extinctions at this time? I mean, the asteroid didn't impact all the dinosaurs at once.
Well, there was a complicated series of events that followed the impact that actually led to the dinosaurs' demise. But some scientists think that the asteroid impact isn't actually the whole story when it comes to how the dinosaurs went extinct. Just for some quick background, the KPG, or Cretaceous-Paleogene mass extinction, which is this event that took out the non-avian dinosaur 66 million years ago, is the most recent of the Big Five mass extinction events. This Big Five refers to the five largest mass extinctions recognized throughout the Phanerozoic Eon, or the last 540 million years. And like I mentioned, while the KPG extinction was not the largest, it is the most famous, mostly because it involves dinosaurs and an asteroid, which are both really cool things. And just to bring us some perspective with regards to geologic time, again, the Phanerozoic Eon, this period of about 540 million years ago to the present, makes up just over 10% of the entire geologic timescale. So about 90% of Earth history happened before this eon even began. So of course there are mass extinction events that happened in the Precambrian before the Phanerozoic began. However, they don't have as well preserved as a fossil record because large multicellular things that made skeletons and hard parts weren't around yet until the very, very end of this time. So the fossil record is lacking for that time period, but I have some videos on my channel about extinction events that happened during that time. If you're interested, I'll link one to the top right. In any case, I show this time scale of the stretched out Phanerozoic Eon because I think it emphasizes just how long dinosaurs were dominant, which is a long time. I mean, it's nearly 200 million years. They evolved around 240, just after the beginning of the Mesozoic era, and they weren't super dominant yet, but then after the late Triassic mass extinction, they rose to dominance because a lot of other groups were heavily hit at that extinction event, and they rose to dominance on land, and mammals remained rodent-like and small, and not even dinosaurs were the dominant land animals for the next 150 so million years until the asteroid impact that ultimately led to their demise. Or so we think. We'll get more into the complications of this in a second. So first, what is our evidence that there was an asteroid impact? Well, there's widespread correlation of an iridium layer, a global iridium layer at this boundary of time in the rock record, which indicates extraterrestrial source material. There's other rock types around the impact site like shocked grains, microspherules, microscopic diamonds, and other types of rocks and structures and stuff of rocks that indicate impact or at least very high temperature, high pressure event. And then, you know, the nail in the coffin for this one was the crater that we found. And so both the crater size and iridium amount indicate that the asteroid was around 10 kilometers or 6 miles wide. And argon dating from the rock layers at this time indicate that it occurred around 66 million years ago in agreement with the mass extinctions that occurred during this time. In addition, all the material indicative of an impact is thicker closer to the impact site, the crater, and species that lived in proximity to the impact site were more heavily affected. But how exactly did an asteroid impact kill all the dinosaurs? Well, we already said the impact itself didn't directly smush all the dinosaurs, but there was a series of climatic and environmental changes that it triggered that drove the actual extinctions. Specifically, the impact caused a series of rapid changes in global temperature, atmospheric and ocean chemistry, and biological activity. So now we'll go through step by step each kind of event that happened immediately after impact with regards to climate and environmental changes, the first being what I'm calling the Broil. So the asteroid impacted and incinerated the rock that it impacted in a 1,500 kilometer radius. So again, the asteroid, only being about 10 kilometers in diameter, ended up completely obliterating a region about 1,500 kilometers in radius. In radius too, so times two for diameter. At the time of impact and immediately following, there were widespread wildfires and tsunamis. Tsunamis because it impacted a region that had water, and obviously, well, very large waves formed as a result. Wildfires because there was intense heating upon impact as well as immediately after. This heat was driven by the massive energy of the impact itself, but also immediately following, it was driven by the re-entry of impact ejecta, so things thrown up into the atmosphere and even up all the way into space from the impact materials and rock fragments and stuff that re-entered the atmosphere to, you know, fall back down to Earth after impact. And this heat from re-entry of impact ejecta was really intense. So intense that it rose Earth's surface temperature to the broiling level of an oven, hence the term the broil. This obviously devastated life on land, but marine life at this time at least remained somewhat protected because of the heat capacity of water. It didn't heat up quite as much due to all of this that was going on in the atmosphere and on the surface. But the second major climate change that happened due to the impact was impact winter. Essentially, sunlight became blocked due to the ash and dust that were thrown up into the upper atmosphere, which greatly limited photosynthesis, devastating both plant life, things that photosynthesize, and animals, the things that rely on the things that photosynthesize.
This devastation of photosynthesizing plants on land and algae in the ocean caused cascading extinctions up the food chain.
In the marine realm, this included, of course, the primary producers themselves, microalgae called coccolithophores, and other base of the food chain type organisms like forams, foraminifera. These are not photosynthesizing algae, but they are protists that were very important at the base of the food chain at the time, still remain very important today, actually, but they were hit really hard at this extinction event, in large part due to this impact winter scenario. Ammonoids were also hit very hard at this extinction. Well, they went extinct completely. I actually have a whole video talking about how and why potentially ammonoids went extinct during this event, while nautiluses, which still live today that are very similar to ammonoids, did not. So I'll link that to the top right if you're interested. Rudists were also hit very hard. Well, they went extinct as well. These were huge, weird-shaped mollusks, as you can see in this picture here, that were actually reef builders at the time. So today in modern oceans, we have mainly corals that build reefs, which is why we typically call them coral reefs. But back in the Mesozoic, there were also mollusks, these rudists, that contributed heavily to the reefs in this huge, you know, 200 plus million year time frame. And due to the fact that base of the food chain organisms, as well as reef building organisms, went extinct, which both of these groups are super important for sustaining ecosystems, this caused cascading extinctions up the food chain, leading to the extinction of even apex predators like mosasaurs and plesiosaurs at the time, which were marine reptiles. On land, the notable extinctions were obviously non-avian dinosaurs, but also, again, many plant species because no photosynthesis, so there go plants.
And this blocking of sunlight also caused a rapid cooling period after the brief broil event, which we call impact winter.
This rapid global cooling likely lasted several months to years and also likely contributed to the extinctions. Again, any rapid change in global temperature or photosynthetic activity, these things heavily affect life. But the ash and aerosols thrown up into the atmosphere by impact didn't just block sunlight and cause cooling. Many of these compounds and aerosols were also very toxic to life. And these toxic chemicals contributed to the biological devastation at the time, on both land and in the ocean.
After the impact winter, the globe warmed for hundreds of thousands of years, if not a million years, after impact, which is still rapid climate change on geologic time. Based on the amount of carbon dioxide released due to the impact, it's estimated that Earth's temperature rose around 7 degrees Celsius or 13 degrees Fahrenheit in this hundreds of thousands to million year time range, which is a lot of degrees in such a geologically short time frame. Again, I've talked in a lot of my videos about how warmth is different than warming. Periods of warmth in Earth's history that took millions, tens of millions, hundreds of millions of years to get to very warm temperatures, global temperatures, are fine. Life can adapt because it adapts over millions of years. But rapid warming in less than a million year timescale, especially of that magnitude, is not something life can adapt to very well. Therefore, this warming likely contributed to the mass extinctions at this time. But how exactly did an asteroid impact cause CO2 to get released and global warming to occur?
Well, what the asteroid impacted matters. This asteroid in particular impacted very carbon-rich rocks. And when it did so, it completely vaporized them to release enormous amounts of carbon in the form of carbon dioxide to the atmosphere. And this carbon dioxide remained in the atmosphere long after the dust that caused impact winter settled.
Rapid warming in the oceans at the time likely devastated reef-building organisms like corals, the rudest mollusks. It also likely weakened ocean circulation and caused ocean anoxia, or depleted oxygen concentrations in the ocean. And it's interesting, I've talked a lot about ocean anoxic events in my past videos, but most of the time, ocean anoxia, or that decrease in oxygen concentrations in the deep ocean especially, is typically caused by an increase in CO2 in the atmosphere and primary productivity at the ocean surface, so algal bloom type activity, and essentially overuse of oxygen in the water column beneath these blooms, which then causes zones of complete anoxia, so no oxygen is present. It's all been used to decompose the algae. But this particular event was associated with extremely limited photosynthetic activity because sunlight was blocked. And photosynthesizing organisms didn't just come back right away after the dust settled and the sun came back. They were, you know, extremely limited for many years following impact. And so this particular ocean anoxic event was actually caused by a lack of oxygen production in the first place, rather than an overuse of oxygen to decompose the organic matter of the primary producers.
And then the fifth major climate change caused by impact was an increase in acid rain. The asteroid impacted more than just carbon. It hit both carbonate, so carbon-containing, and sulfate, sulfur-containing rocks, which released carbon dioxide and sulfur dioxide to the atmosphere, which in the atmosphere, these compounds react with water to form acid, carbonic and sulfuric acid. So that led to a bunch of acid rain, especially in proximity to the impact. And we can actually see the proximity to impact kind of effect going on with the sinkholes that formed due to this acid rain dissolving limestone in this region. So you can actually kind of make out this radial pattern of sinkholes around the Chicxulub crater, which is really cool. And of course, the acid rain would have also contributed to extinctions at the time.
And then the sixth and final major effect that this impact had on climate at the KPG boundary was ocean acidification. The sulfur dioxide and carbon dioxide that the impact released due to the rocks that it vaporized upon impact reacted with seawater and lowered ocean pH. This severely impacted organisms that build calcium carbonate skeletons, shells, and other hard parts. Most notably at the time, things like forams and coccolithophores, again, those primary producers, base of the food chain type organisms that are really important for, you know, the rest of the food chain. And if they go extinct, they cause cascading extinctions. Also, you know, your corals and mollusks, things like rudists, reef builders, other coral species, reef builders. Reef builders are super important for ecosystems. And when they go extinct, they cause cascading extinctions. This is why ocean acidification has been one of the major causes of mass extinctions throughout Earth's history. But what about after the extinctions.
Life did recover, as we know, being here today, after this extinction event. On land, notably mammals, essentially replaced non-avian dinosaurs, and avian dinosaurs, birds, diversified like crazy, and that's why we have so many species of birds today. And in the sea, we had sharks and then later marine mammals kind of replace the whole niche that was marine reptiles in the Mesozoic, which is super cool. I actually have a video about kind of marine reptiles and the niche that they hold now being held by marine mammals and that kind of concept of convergent evolution. I'll link that video to the top right for you if you're interested. And then the other major change in the sea was that rudest reefs, mollusk reefs, were replaced by coral reefs, or at least predominantly coral reefs, which is what we have today.
So now we've gone through the asteroid impact, all the major climate changes that it caused, the effects it had on life at the time in the ocean and on land, the recovery of life after the fact, but are we missing something from this story? Some scientists think we are.
Well, it's clear that there was massive volcanism occurring at this time in what we call now the Deccan Traps in peninsular India. But whether this increase in volcanic activity at this time played a role in the mass extinctions remains debated. Some think that this rapid increase in volcanic activity did contribute to the mass extinctions, while others think it was unrelated and didn't affect life much. While others think the impact may have caused the increase in volcanic activity, even though the impact and the volcanism took place on fully separate hemispheres, both latitudinally and longitudinally. So, which of these scenarios is it? I will be answering this question in much more detail in the part two to this video, which is on the GEO Society channel, the Geological Society of America GEO Society YouTube channel, which should go up the same day as this video. So it should be up now, and I will hopefully link it somewhere on the screen for you guys. So go check that out now. Like always, references are linked down below, and I'll see you in that video over on GEO Society. Bye.